change my mind. They said you might be up here.
Give me your hand.
I wanted to do the movie because I thought it was going to be very emotional, and it was like the story of the sinking of this ship, but it had Romeo and Juliet in it. And I said, what a great story to do, where the audience knows that it's going to end badly, but you sort of pull them in and fall in love with the characters, even though they know it's going to end badly. And that's the success of the movie, that it has this wonderful love story in it. And I just wanted to be involved with that.
All right. Open your eyes.
I'm flying!
In the world of music, movies, and composers, he has demystified the language a little bit for us. Mm-hmm. So he doesn't create a distance between us and him by using the language of music as an obstacle.
In fact, it's like having a conversation with a writer or an actor or another director. James Horner and I have worked together a number of times, and James is a wonderful storyteller. He loves movies, and he really understands how to help tell the story.
We have liftoff. Yes, sir. We have cleared the tower in 13:13.
It's mysterious. Look, music's mysterious. Why does one thing work and another not? It can be very intimidating. And over the course of our now 7 collaborations, the thing that's exciting for me is that I talk to James the way I would talk to a writer or even an actor, trying to create a performance, a character, trying to create a character.
When I saw that score, I gotta say, about 95% of that score was just spot on from the minute it hit the picture, you know? And it's not the same with every score. You have to fiddle with some scores, you know? That's one of the great scores, I think. It sort of rivals, you know, Lawrence of Arabia score or any of the great scores. It's one of the great scores. And Horner delivered. Big time with that score. That's a great score.
Catch a good game.
Thank you. So beautiful here.
For me.
Well, for me, it's like a dream come true. Can I ask you something? Is this heaven?
It's Iowa.
Iowa?
We showed it to James Horner, who was deciding whether or not to score the film. He came in to look at it at an early stage. He was the first person not associated with the movie to that point to see it. He was the first person coming in cold. And we showed him the film, and when the lights came up, he got up and left the room. And I thought, oh my God, it's so bad he can't even say, it's interesting, but you know what, fellas, I'm too busy to do it. He just left the room. And I almost, the veins in my wrist opened up almost by themselves. And his agent, Mike Gorfain, said, geez, fella, I'm sorry. I don't know what to say. You know, I apologize. And he went out into the hallway and he came back and he said, James is composing himself out there. He was so moved. And he was, in fact, he came back in very teary-eyed and he said, I'm speechless. And I said, well, you don't have to say much, just say yes. And he said, yes. And that's the day I thought, wow, this is different. This is good.
I knew nothing about baseball. You once asked me if I was a baseball fan, and I think I may have lied to get the movie. And said, oh, yeah, yeah, love it, love it. 50-yard line.
Is there a heaven?
Oh, yeah. It's the place dreams come true.
This is heaven.
Mother! Mother? Oh. Please get up.
I'm not sure I can, Littlefoot.
Yes, you can. Get up.
Do you remember the way to the Great Valley?
I guess so. But why do I have to know? You're gonna be with me.
I'll be with you. Even if you can't see me.
What do you mean, if I can't see you? I can always see you.
Littlefoot, let your heart guide you. It whispers. So listen closely.
Mother? Mother?
Casper? If my mom's a ghost, did she forget about me?
No. She'd never forget you.
Cat?
If I were alive, would you go to the Halloween dance with me? Cat? Can I keep you?
Casper, close the window. It's cold.
Tell us if you can give me just a little bit more volume, basses as well, against the violas. 63. One, two, three. Maybe just a little less violas.
We rehearse the cues, as they're called, the pieces of music, and sometimes my pieces of music tend to be very, very long, and we do it section by section, and then we project it, and then I conduct the orchestra while we're recording, watching the projection in the back.
nice, you know, to the euphoria.
Father, Colonel Ludlow, sir.
Oh, what's going on here?
What's going on here?
Wanna play?
Two minutes. What's that?
Schliemann attack.
Where'd you learn that from? A book?
No, my teacher taught me.
Oh, your teacher. Well, forget it. Play like you used to, from the gut. Get your pawns rolling on the queen side. Come and get me.
Put it out. Josh is playing.
See, he didn't teach you how to win. He taught you how not to lose. That's nothing to be proud of. You're playing not to lose, Josh. You got to risk losing. You got to risk everything. You got to go to the edge of defeat. That's where you want to be, boy. On the edge of defeat.
But
what? Play. Never play the board, always the man.
You gotta play the man playing the board. Play me. I'm your opponent. You have to beat me, not the board. Beat me.
You're not who I have to play.
You're playing me now. Come on, beat me. Better.
All right.
Better, yes. Come on, move. Good. Yeah. All right. Better. Yeah. Good. Move. Yeah. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yes. Move. Ooh, yeah. Good, good, good. Move. Yeah, that's it. Ooh, good. Yeah. What's that?
Mate.
Remember, always strong. Check it off. Strong. Left foot back. Right feet back. Left feet back. Pick up his jacket.
Oh,
focus.
Okay.
Always concentrate. Left back. Right foot back. Pick up his jacket. Stay.
In this film, it would have been easy for the filmmakers to use a lot of songs, but they've chosen to use score. I think audiences are more sophisticated than filmmakers think. Even kids can be a classical score. People do respond to that kind of thing, and Will and Harold have been really smart that way, in that they've been thinking, what's the story all the way through, and not just isolating certain scenes, and wouldn't it be great to have a lot of energy here, and put in hip-hop here, and hip-hop here. They've been very conscious of how the whole thing works.
Pick up your jacket. Strong. Hanging up. Hanging up! Hang up. Attitude. Strike. Hang up and attitude. Harder. Harder. Good.
Big action hero movie, but I wanted to add colors that you would never associate with a movie like that and pull out emotions that aren't associated with a movie like this. The action stuff will take care of itself. It's going to look great and it's going to sound great. The part that is really important are the in-between bits, what Peter's thinking, when he gets pensive, when he loses a family member, when he is developing this relationship with Gwen. It's really important to bring out the understory, the human story, for me. And that's just the way I like to write scores. Over the last 2.5 years, we've talked several times about my thoughts about flying. I used to fly when I was younger. I never had a mentor. It was all self-induced. I grew up around air shows and airplanes. I found somebody who sort of shared my love of airplanes, because I was always doing it alone. And it just happened to be Ed. Ed, of all people, is like not only an airplane person, but obviously a skilled aerobatic pilot as well. And I started going up with the three horsemen pilots sitting in the back of the Mustang while they were doing their aerobatic routines and sort of getting used to the feelings of spatially what was going on and what the airplane smelled like and what it was like to be upside down and doing aerobatics and be in formation to other airplanes. And I just sort of fell in love with it, re-fell in love with it, decided to relearn, re-qualify myself to fly again. I'm very grateful to the lot of them, and it's opened my eyes to a lot of things. To be able to be so immersed in my world and be able to step out and learn a new skill that requires such precision and such a gift, and sort of relearn, rejigger stuff I used to know so long ago and do both, that's truly a unique experience. We talked probably about a year ago, you know, just fancifully, what my thoughts were musically, what did I think of when I saw airplanes. Ed asked me about writing a piece for The Horseman that both encapsulated my feelings about flight and my experiences of what it was like flying with them, that would become a blueprint that they would fly to, like a choreography. I was writing a piece of ballet music that people would dance to, or in this case, fly to. Most important, it'll be a marriage between the music and the flying that people will remember. They'll remember the experience of watching the horsemen fly. And for me, the marriage is the most important thing. And they'll say, what a great display. And that's the perfect sort of outcome of something that I could contribute to the horsemen. It was the first project that I've been able to write in a very long time where I haven't had a director dictating to me all the parameters, and I haven't had a script that I've had to catch all kinds of details every minute or in hundredths of a second or things like that, the way I usually have to work. I was given a clean slate from the beginning to the end and just said go. Basically just fly and write your soul and write your heart. That's what I did. And it was so liberating to be able to write a piece like that, that had no encumbrances on it. One, two. This allowed me to really do something that was so free. To me, it was so much like flying. I mean, I keep using this analogy, and what came out of me had no time constraints and was boundless. And I think sounds like that. The orchestra I use is a group, I think we had 88 people yesterday. And it's a orchestral group that I use on most of my films. I know all of these people. I work with them on every film I do. I wanted to somehow convey to them the magic of what it was like to fly, what it was like to float, to have that sort of suspension. I wanted to somehow entrap them in this web that what they were playing, I felt very special about, and who they were playing for, I felt very special about. And I didn't want them to just treat it as another gig. I wanted them to feel from my heart that it was something I felt very deeply about. I've been in this routine with these guys, and to write a piece that you know is going to be flown to, and to write a texture with the pianos having this floating sort of nowhere music, it's the strangest thing. There's no key, it's just this sort of starlight, and that's how I hear it. It's serene, and for those who fly, they know the feeling. The three horsemen have so graciously sort of encapsulated me in the family as the fourth horseman, and it's the first time I really feel like I've carried my weight, that I've contributed something important to the group that perhaps nobody else could have. At the same time, they've taken me under their wing and are teaching me aerobatics and are teaching me flying. And as I get better at that, there's hope that one day I'll be flying to this same piece that I wrote, which is just such a strange thought, which I was thinking as I was conducting it. The music will be part of something much bigger than the music is by itself. Music's part of something magical, which are these airplanes moving in formation, and that's what people will take away. And that will be this year, and that will be next year, and as they perfect their routine, they'll be in lockstep with the piece, and ideally it will become just a flowing signature for them.
Oscar-winning composer James Horner is believed to have died after his plane crashed in Southern California.
The crash happened about 100 miles north of Los Angeles on Monday. The pilot has not officially been identified, but Horner's personal assistant as well as director Ron Howard have both come out saying it was Horner who died in the crash. He's been nominated for 10 Academy Awards, winning two Oscars for the 1997 Best Picture, Titanic. James Horner was 61 years old.